I started working with glass when I was at the University of Washington doing textiles in 1962 or three, and I fused little bits of wire into glass and put them in a tapestry and got very involved with glass and very interested in the colors. And one night I melted a bunch of stained glass in a little kiln and stuck a piece of gas pipe on the floor into it and blew a bubble, which was, I was very lucky that I got a bubble, because it's something that you might not get without somebody telling you what to do. But fate had it that night that I would get a bubble. And interestingly enough, I had never seen glass blowing prior to having done this. And I must have, you know, seen a movie or read it in a book or something. But so I got a little bubble and got very excited. And then I proceeded to try to do some research as to how I could learn about, you know, go to study glass blowing. And it didn't take long to find that Harvey Littleton had started a program at the University of Wisconsin in 1962. So I applied there as a graduate student and was accepted and went there in 1966.
Dale had a background in weaving before he came to us. And I think that has always been a part of the underlying structure of his work. The sense of surface embellishment, the sense of the interweaving of these threads and so on, a delicacy, the shimmering fabric of the glass is similar to the shimmering fabric that you might use as a weaver or as a designer for cloth material expressions.
Blow. Stop. Blow. Stop.
What I like about glass is really the blowing process. That's what really infatuates me. And I have never gotten tired of the possibilities of what you can do with a blowpipe. There's just something about, you know, blowing this human breath into this tube, and this thing blows up, and then working with the fire and the centrifugal force, and it's, you know, this working with glass symmetrically doesn't interest me very much. I mean, I'm interested in letting the glass do sort of what it wants to do and taking advantage of the gravity and the centrifugal force and these aspects. And it's a very spontaneous medium if you let it be. Glass blowing, you know, goes back a couple of thousand years, but I like to think of it as being really developed in Murano from about 1000 to 16th or 17th century. It really flourished in there. And the Venetians were very clever to isolate the glass blowers on the island of Murano, and it was a tremendous commodity for them. In spite of this secretive tradition in Europe and Murano, I was fortunate enough to go there in 1968 on a grant and spent 9 months working at the Vanini factory in Murano.
What color is this on the white in here?
And that's when I really learned about teamwork. I mean, you know, at this point in 1968 in America, we could barely blow glass. And it's only in the last 5 or 6 years that the Americans have become really, really good craftsmen. I really consider, and you know, in my mind, this is a group of the best glassblowers in the country. And it's important that I can accumulate the best skills that I can find. And it's kind of just lucky that I'm able to get these people. I mean, it's lucky in a lot of ways in that the medium itself lends itself towards this phenomenon to have happened. The difference between this team, say, and a team in Italy, a great glassblowing team in Italy would be made up of men who went to work in the factory at a very young age, at 12 or 14 years old. They hardly even went to school, certainly never went to art school. And they're great craftsmen and a great tradition. But they don't think, you know, any way, in any manner, like this team does, you know, which are, everybody here has probably got a degree in art, if not a master's degree in art, and maybe a couple of other degrees besides, you know, and they understand what I'm talking about. If I have a discussion with them about something, they understand this, and they realize that this is, it goes far beyond just skills.
We're gonna have a white lip wrap on this.
Right, we are. Right, right there, down, down, brother, down. Okay, four, come here. You might have to reheat this charge, not all the way in.
I like working with people in a team, and it, you know, I probably would have picked some form of expression that would have allowed me to work with people, I think, no matter what it would have been. I would have been a, you know, a filmmaker or an architect, or it's just not my style, I suppose, to want to sit working in a studio alone all day long. And the teamwork, you know, not only, of course, did it allow me to make things that I couldn't have done alone, it gives me a lot of inspiration.
Okay, I'll come in real slow.
He'll do a little work with the Lincoln log.
He built that log cavity.
I'll come in slow when you say.
Hit me right there on that joint.
Okay, yeah, that's what you need to do.
Here at Harvey's, we're working on a series of soft cylinders, and with these drawings on them, and they're really a development of a series that I did in 1975 that I call the Navajo blanket cylinders.
Dale, you're going for broke.
It was a drawing technique that we developed the year before at Pilchuck. Myself and some friends figured out that you could lay little bits of glass down and come over with the molten glass and pick up this drawing.
You want to hit this with a torch?
I will, as soon as he rolls back.
I meant to have him put that down a little lower than usual.
I'm just going to flip it right on over, Joey, if I can.
Wow, good drawing.
Octopus.
Now, it seems like a very simple thing now, and a lot of people are doing it besides myself. But in actual fact, it was a new technique, as far as I can tell, that had never been done, because it's one of those examples of a technique that you can't duplicate. No matter how you lay that glass down there, every time you pick it up, it's going to be a little different. Well, that didn't lend itself very well to factories. So this technique could have been developed by factories, you know, sometime in the last 2,000 years, but they never did, because they like to be able to do the same thing over and over. So here was a lovely technique that we were able to develop, because it wasn't useful to factories.
I was going to do only white threads around it.
Looking good so far, Daniel.
Yeah.
The team is made up, you know, as you can see here, it's made up of about 6 or 7 people. Sometimes the team is fewer, but each person has their specific job to do. That's the concept of the teamwork in working with glass. Benny, in this case, is doing the starting, and Rich is doing the finishing.
4 hands, 6 hands, 8 hands in a medium that's as taxing as working with glass is, makes it so much simpler. It's enables you to keep a clear head about what it is that you're doing, and to have assistants working with you is of utmost importance to me.
Ben is really responsible for how all the color goes on the piece. He puts on the initial color, and that's the beginning bubble, is in those first couple of ounces of color. And that's all the color that there'll be on the inside. And then Benny will go in and gather and come over with the hot glass and pick up the white clouds. And the reason for these white clouds, other than the fact that they're an element in themselves as clouds, that white opaque glass offers a buffer between the next layer of color and the first layer of color. After Benny has put on the clouds, he then heats it up and marvers the clouds in. He smooths them on that steel plate that's called a marver. So he reheats two or three times and he brings it over and rolls it on the marver. And after that setup, he then gathers in the furnace once again. And goes over and picks up some little colored bits of glass that we call jimmies.
Yeah. How did you ever come by that name?
Because when you get an ice cream cone on the East Coast, and they put
this happens to be East Coast.
Yeah. They put those little sprinkles on them.
In Rhode Island, they call them jimmies.
That coating of jimmies is now the exterior color. The jimmies have to be once again smoothed out, and then the piece is usually handed over to Rich. And Rich is the gaffer on this team in this particular series of work. And he knows basically the kind of form that I would like to make. Rich will then take the piece and with Robbie's help, it'll be inflated, it'll be blown up again, and a neck will be put in the piece.
Dale has an amazing ability to delegate responsibility, which I think is very important because it leaves him free to stand back and view the stuff from a different perspective. Where I sit at the bench, being a foot and a half away from this piece, I really can't see it as well as he can being 4 or 5 feet away.
Right on the left.
You could do it right now. I could be doing it right now.
Another thing about Dale that I find is truly amazing is his generosity and his ability to communicate. He's generous to a fly. I mean, the guy will do anything just to make sure his workers are happy.
With us, you do have to be a particular kind of person. The chemistry has to be right within the team. But we have a pretty good time at it, too. We all have a pretty good sense of humor. And we're pretty serious. Although it's a lot of fun, we're all pretty serious about what we're doing.
Getting to the point where I don't care anymore. I'm lonely.
In the beginning, I started to draw so that they'd know what forms I wanted to use to make. And then I got really interested in just drawing itself. I don't want to stay out there on the floor all the time telling people what to do. So I often stand back and watch them and draw. So it was from drawing around the shop that I developed these techniques of drawing over textures and, you know, peas and rice and things, and using a handful of pencils made me, I could do it a lot faster. And so my work is very fast and spontaneous, and so all the drawings are that way as well.
Hand me one of those, something with blue or green in it.
And I also like to use whatever liquids are around. Like I use, you know, the juices, cranberry juice, and I use tea and coffee for the colors, and we use a lot of bitters in soda water, and so bitters make very great color on the watercolors. And sometimes if we're in Vienna, we use the wine from the country, and if we're working at the seashore, I use shells underneath the drawings, and that's just because it's convenient and has a flavor of the locale. If Flora is working on a drawing, You know, she knows basically the type of drawings that I like, and I'll make little drawings for her, and she'll, you know, she's a, you know, extremely intuitive, sensitive person that can understand. She really wants to make what I want.
Is this the back drawing the same width as this, or was this wider to begin with?
No, that one, the top one here was a lot thinner.
Which one is stretched out more?
This one.
And what is this, a chartreuse?
Yeah, it's black.
You know, it'd be nice to get a something where you group some circles for a, take a look up, like in that upper right-hand corner, and maybe make those circles out of several dots each.
I'll do that one after this.
Perfect.
Oh, I hate to say Dale could have been a used car salesman, but he could have done really anything he wanted to do. He likes to play, but I say that play only in the real positive sense. Creative people like to play, and that's how creation starts. You have to be free enough to play, and then it will come. So he likes to play with the material, and he likes to play because out of play comes conversation, out of conversation comes growth, and out of a question will come a conversation that everybody will try to answer.
I can hand place it on afterwards.
No, I want to be below the drawing. No, it might not pick up the drawing.
No,
we cut
up
strips. Give me a scissors. Give me a scissors.
1 minute. Mostly, my usefulness to the team comes from my background, which, again, is not that I'm a good glass blower, but it is that I've painted for years. And I basically come up with the color combinations for Dale's work and do a lot of the experimenting for him, in the sense that oftentimes I will work sometimes when Dale isn't there so that he can come in and look at certain color combinations. So what I'll do in the morning is I'll pick the interior colors, I'll pick the outside color, I'll find out what floor is making for the shards, and I'll try and put all those together.
I have a lapis and celadon up there. I can cut off the celadon and put it away and pick up. I've only got two.
Okay, just throw the celadon away. It's not very much left.
Okay.
And then we'll go right to that.
Okay.
And then if we've done 7 before lunch, we'll do 7 probably after, so I've almost got that.
If Joey's setting up the drawing, that's what she gets from Flora, and adds the thread. She knows the colors I like. She knows the feeling I like. And but they have a lot of input, you know, that certain they'll think it looks better this way or that way. We'll discuss it, and it ends up to be a conglomeration of a lot of people's thinking. After Rich puts on the neck, and he goes back to the furnace and gets a gather of hot glass, waits a few seconds to get the temperature just right, and then he comes down on that drawing that Flora and Joey have preheated so that this hot glass doesn't shock the drawing so that it breaks.
Okay, heat it up. Beautiful the way those white threads went. Beautiful.
Boy, she likes those drawings hot.
This other agency down.
It's clear behind
right there. Okay.
And then he immediately goes over to the glory hole to begin to fuse it in. And then it's a process of marvering, smoothing out that drawing, smoothing out the whole, the entire form now has gotten sort of out of shape. And so he wants to get it symmetrical again. So he gets it the way he wants it, and then he begins to blow up the piece. So once that's blown up to the desired size, a button is put on the end of the piece. And that little button that's put on the end allows a little more thickness of glass to be there so that when the putty is put on and later taken off, it won't break.
Hello?
Then the putty is put on by Robbie, and Rich then chills the neck, gets it to just the right temperature. He hits the blowpipe and the piece breaks off.
Back-eyed piece.
Robbie takes it into the glory hole. The glory hole is a very hot box that's maybe 2,500 degrees that allows it to be a little hotter than if you tried to reheat it in the furnace.
You might even be able to sneak one more out of that.
And then it's brought back over to the bench. Rich opens up the lip a little bit. And then Annabelle is since heated up the color that will be what's called the lip wrap. And the lip wrap is then added by Rich.
People often think the glass blowers have to go fast. But it's not a question of going fast. It's just a question of having your timing be right on. Sometimes you have to go slowly. I'm sure you've noticed the guy sometimes just sitting around waiting for the piece to cool. The movements have to be right on. You have to not bump into each other. In that sense, you sort of have to be somewhat graceful. You sort of dance around each other in the shop. You have very hot things on the end of long rods, and you can't bump them into each other, and you have to work around everybody.
Do a couple of those wraps where it goes down a couple of times.
Okay. Okay.
Okay. He reheats it in the glory hole a couple of times, opens it up just the way he wants to, and then he goes in for the final reheat and brings it out and gets the form, you know, in a way which satisfies us.
You could probably turn that small
grill down. Flatten the top. I'll do it this time.
That celadon may be soft.
It's got a little flare at the lip, that's not too bad.
You want these?
Nah.
Ready for me?
Yeah, on the back.
Joey comes over with a torch. She heats up the punty, make sure that the temperature is just right, then she'll heat up the drawing to get what we call a reduction surface on the drawing, bring out a little bit of the precious metals like silver or gold that might be in the colors. And then Rich will then take some water and chill the punny a little bit, knock it off, and Robbie will put it in the oven.
I like all these little...
That interior color looks like it's gonna be good.
Sure does.
Yeah, it's
gonna
be hot. We're talking hot yellow. Kind of nestle these down in here.
Nestle now.
Yay! I feel like I'm actually a craftsman, a designer. I'm all of these things, you know. Maybe I'm an artist. I probably have a little bit of all of these things in me. And maybe that's what makes the glass a little different than a craft or an art, or maybe it's somewhere in between all of these things.
Yeah, we started putting a couple of drawings on.
Oh, that's nice. What color red is that?
69.
Wow, that's
beautiful
drawing.
Little drawing.
This must be 14 down in here.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
This is the aspect of the art that interests me is the audience. Much more so than the fact that people call it art. Call it craft, I don't care what they call it. You know, I mean, somewhere down long after I'm dead, somebody will figure out what it was and how important it was. In the meantime, I get my kicks out of people seeing the work.